Okay, so we're going to do a small little presentation, and I'm going to talk about copyright for architecture in India. Now, so you know, there's a concept in business. You know, business revolves around the concept of profit. So does profession, because there is a lot of concentration of the idea of earning money behind people doing a lot of professions, even though profession has other aims as well. But you know, there, to even run a profession, you know, where it can sustain itself, you need to worry about the business. And then there is a concept of profit. And there are other concepts like assets, liabilities, equity, capital, which form the basis of capitalism. And you know, we acquire profits to create assets, and assets in turn generate more profit for us. So what is an asset? Asset is an economic resource that the entity has as a result of activities in the past through which future benefits can be reaped. And what are the types of assets? They can be, you know, intangible, they can be tangible. So we're going to talk about intangible assets. So what are intangible assets? They are which do not exist in physical form and could not be touched or felt by us, but they're essential for the entity, because they help in generating cash flow, you know, help us in future cash flows, and we can get economic benefits out of them. So what are the types of intangible assets? Goodwill, brand equity, research and development, customer lists, licensing and rights, and intellectual property, what we're going to talk about today. What is intellectual property? Intellectual property is the creation of the mind. You know, it is such inventions, literary and artistic works, designs, symbols, names, and images used in commerce. This is a WIPO definition. WIPO is the World Intellectual Property Organization. So the concept here is every man owns what he creates. So what are the types of intellectual property? We know certain types of intellectual property. These are copyright, patents, trademarks, industrial designs, and geographical indications, and trade secrets, of course. So, you know, I'm asking this question, have you seen this before? You know, you see this in books, you see this in videos, you see this so many places. This is the symbol for copyright. So what is copyright? Copyright is the, or author's right, you know, is a legal term to describe literary and artistic works, you know, that people have created. And they can be, you know, books, they can be music, they can be painting, they can be sculpture, they can be films, they can be computer programs, databases, advertisements, maps, technical drawings, and works of architecture. As we see, this again is a WIPO definition. But what is not copyright? Well, there's two extremes. One is in the public domain, one is copyright. But now we have certain thing in the middle, and that is called Creative Commons, which we're going to see right here. See, Creative Commons license spectrum. Here you can see that this right here is copyright, and this is public domain. And in the middle, we have other options, you know, other options, as if, you know, like, for example, this is Creative Commons by here. If you're using somebody's work, you have to give attribute to who the creator was. And this NC means it cannot be used for commercial purposes. So, and there are other definitions which can be easily seen from the Creative Commons website. This in itself is a big topic for discussion, but this gives us, you know, some flexibility between these two poles, that is public domain and copyright. But why people did create Creative Commons? Why people opted for Creative Commons when we had an established system of copyright? That is because, you know, as a fact, 91% of the technologies receiving the Nobel Prize were not patented. And, you know, open access of knowledge is critical. Patents should be shared, especially in the times of global emergencies like the COVID pandemic. Because people need to get access to medicines, vaccines, and the patents and copyright should be freely available. And another reason is that people believe in the concept of sharing is caring. And you know, when people open up their, for example, computer programs, it helps the program, because a lot of people, the user base increases and it becomes crowdsourced. And what happens is that, you know, because of making it open to public, the product improvement happens exponentially. Then, you know, because of the internet and because of the information technology, there has been cases of privacy and privacy, not privacy, sorry, piracy. And piracy has become so rampant. So, what some people choose, they know that it might get pirated. So they release it in the first place in the form of an open license. Though, there are requirements like you have to give attribute. And, they people are now looking, performers are now looking for alternate means of creation of income. You see, nowadays movies certainly have advertisements right in the script. What the hero is drinking, what the hero is eating, what the hero is wearing is part of the whole the economic resources creation in making performances, pictures, movies, and art today. And also, the main reason is because of these two poles of copyright and public domain, you needed to have a middle ground between commercialization and absolutely no regulation. Coming back to copyright, which is our topic today, copyright in India is protected under the Copyright Act in 1957. So there are separate acts for the design. Designs are separate. Patents are separate. Trademarks are separate. Geographical indications are separate. Plant varieties are separate. Semiconductors and biological diversity is also separate acts. So copyright is totally a separate thing altogether, governed by a separate office, governed by a separate ministry. Copyright in India is by under Ministry of Education, formerly known as Ministry of Human Resource Development, whereas patents and designs are in another ministry. What is the copyright framework in India? So there are three tiers framework. They are not in any order. They are not in any hierarchy. So one is Copyright Office, which basically is the administrators, the clerks, the executives, the record keepers, the office that runs this whole copyright thing in India. Then there is a Copyright Societies. These can be said as the unions for creators, like IRRO is for books, for reprographic rights. Then IPRS is for performing rights for singers and composers. PPL India is for performing, and radio broadcast. So this is for decentralization of copyright work, and people who are experts should sit in among themselves and then give copyrights among themselves so that the work gets decentralized and has more credibility. Because the people who are in the field themselves, take decisions. Then there is a Copyright Board, which the original Act had stated. Now this in 2017 has been merged with a Common Intellectual Property Appellate Board. This acts like the Supreme Court, So what is the Supreme Court? Is the where the interpretation of law happens. So the Copyright Board, this is now Intellectual Property Appellate Board, acts a place where the interpretation of law will happen in cases where interpretation of law is required. The question of law is open. Where it is not straightforward, it requires some interpretation. Then Copyright Act 1957, coming to architecture, so it protects all kind of artistic works, and architectural work is artistic work according to the Copyright Act 1957. This was inserted in 1994 into the Act. And you can see even the create, like you create a drawing. So apart from just creating the building, even the drawing, according to this, if it falls under the category of Copyright Act in artistic work. Now, a question to all of you is that if a architect designs a bridge, is it protected under the Copyright Act? By the way, this is the Millau Viaduct, and this had an architect called Norman Foster, a very world-renowned architect, who was in the capacity of an architect for the bridge. So will this be protected under Copyright Act? Same thing, in India, there is Howrah Bridge in Kolkata. So when with this Howrah Bridge was made, could it be registered under copyright? Because it under the works of architecture category. So we need to answer these questions. The answer is that no, because copyright is only for artistic character and design and shall not extend to processes or methods of construction. Whereas people can differ in my view. People can say, no, it can be registered. But who decides that? Maybe there is an artistic character in the bridge also. So this onus is on the author to show artistic character. Bridges are functional elements as such and having no artistic characters. So we need to give this onus to the artist who creates it. And this usually happens when there is either you go for registration and then they will decide whether it is artistic or not. Second case is there was no registration of copyright and there was a question whether this was infringement or not. Then, we'll figure out whether it's a case of infringement or not. So it's a very case-to-case basis kind of a situation. So whole is more crucial than parts. Now we are immediately coming to the deliberations that were made in 1909 congressional report on the bill, original bill in America, the Copyright Act of America, we are quoting here, because of the extensive work that they have done. And this can be a beacon light for architects in India with respect to copyright. Now they are saying that that is the whole arrangement of the individual elements. See, creativity in architecture frequently takes the form of a selection, coordination of arrangement of unprotectable elements into an original protectable whole. It is not the individual elements, but the whole synergetical creation that can be copyrighted. An architect may incorporate new protectable design elements into otherwise standard unprotectable building features and still maintain protection, and interior architecture may be protected. This was 1909. This has, you know, been interpreted, reinterpreted many times since then. But the essence remains that the whole is more crucial than the parts in an architectural creation. So in USA, again, they were, that the aesthetically pleasing overall shape of an architectural work is what matters. And the work should be defined by the poetic language of the architectural work. Now, what does this mean? That only elevations can be protected. Elevations of the building, the views of the building. But the internal, pragmatic, serious business of construction, the technical requirements, the functional requirements, they are not covered under the Copyright Act. So that means that plans, building plans can be copied as per this report and of the USA 1909 congressional report and the other work that has happened there. How much of this is valid in India? This will be based on whether there is some case law in India. Right now, as of now, there is no case law as such of architectural work. But if there is, then these things can serve as a beacon light. So, you know, like, what about an elevation? So, you know, it talks about elevations, as we said, no, that elevations cannot be copied and they are copyrighted. But what about two elevations which are just simple, same doors and windows? So the test, you know, they made a test, how to check that. So first question that they have to ask is, are their original design elements present? Number two, are the original design elements functional? So if the original design elements are present and they are non-functional, then copyright is given. If there are original design elements present and they are functional, copyright is not given. So function is not the deciding factor. The deciding factor is the cosmetic beauty, the difference of how the building looks. So that means, you know, all architects, you know, who are following modern architecture, they should start giving cosmetic features to the building. So what is stealing of copyright in case of architectural work? So this is Lotus Temple by Faribault Saba, who's very much with us and who's designed this great building. And, you know, this is the Baha'i Temple in New Delhi, India, which is also called the Lotus Temple. So, for example, people are selling these small mementos and, you know, home decor of the Lotus Temple. So is it infringement of copyright? I'm going to ask you. A person is selling, you know, a t-shirt with the imprint of Lotus Temple on it. Is it copyright infringement? And then somebody, you know, a teacher takes students to the to Lotus Temple and students start drawing sketches of it. And, you know, one of the students, for example, starts selling those sketches and he becomes rich. So is this infringement? So will the architect come and ask that student to you, give me a share of the money that you have made out of the sketch you have made of my building? Is the question I'm going to ask you. So the answer to this is that we're going to answer soon, but to give you a hint, you can make mementos, prints, engravings, and sketches of the building without any problem, because you're not using that, you're not making another building out of it. Yeah, you're just using a small engraving, painting, drawing out of the work of architecture. So that is allowed, you can do it. So it is basically no infringement of copyright. Now, this is which building's jali is this? Anybody who sees this building will immediately say, this is white marble, jali in Mughal work, this is Taj Mahal. But this is not Taj Mahal. This is the Jali of Bibi Ka Maqbara in Aurangabad. So on the left is the photograph of Bibi Ka Maqbara, Aurangabad. On right is the Taj Mahal. These buildings look so much alike. So much alike that, you know, we can ask that, is it stealing of design? See, same minarets, same kind of dome, same kind of pathway leading to it. It just looks like a copy. Of course, there are differences, but it looks more or less a copy. And, you know, this person in India, he made a Taj Mahal replica for his wife's tomb. So is this a copy? Then, you know, people are selling these small, small marble copies of the Taj Mahal as mementos. Is this a copy? Then in Delhi, they made the Wonder Waste to Wonder Park out of waste materials, and they also made the Taj Mahal. So is this a copy? Now, to answer, these are not copies. The only copy is Bibi Ka Maqbara. If Bibi Ka Maqbara would have been done today, and let's say we are having this presentation during the time of Aurangzeb, during the time of the Mughals, then, you know, by the test of law, Bibi Ka Maqbara would most probably fall as a copyright infringement of the Taj Mahal. Whereas this will not, because these are smaller replicas. And, you know, but you can say that why is this one, this Taj Mahal, not replica? Because it is also a tomb that this man has made for his wife. And this also copies the proportions. So, you know, in these cases, what is the test? So we are following the another rules that what should a court check when comparing similarities between two buildings? They should check for the footprint and dimension, layout of floor plans, number of rooms, wall height, roof pitch, dimensions, overall square footage, number and placement of windows, facade style, silhouette of the building, and the overall look and feel of the building. Again, the matter comes that when we compare all these individual elements, what matters is the overall look and feel of the building, which can be tested by a layman only. You cannot have experts, you cannot have biased people, you cannot have architects, you cannot have the person who is putting the case of copyright infringement, you cannot be a person who is defending the case. It has to be a layman who will decide that. So this will be very subjective and be done on a case-to-case basis. There cannot be one yardstick. Even though we can go nearer and nearer to creating a yardstick by having these rules, but it will be a subjective case-to-case matter. So for example, you know, there, this is this building, if you can guess, this is the One World Trade Center built near the Ground Zero, where the two twin towers were destroyed due to a terrorist attack in 9/11. So they have made this new tower, and there the student, sued the teacher who was in the panel of in the jury, that this is a copy of the design that he had, that was made as a submission to the class. Now the thing is that the court, the case on went on for long. It was decided amicably, I think, and even though the teacher had access to the work, because, you know, to do copyright infringement, one of the requirements that you should have access to the work. So the teacher had access to the work because the student had submitted it. The court said that the idea of twisting towers with rectangular bases and parallel planes was by no means unique, and there was no evidence that the architect could have only thought of the design by viewing the student's work, even though this is how the case was settled. But I'm trying to say that these cases, which are unprecedented, are reminding us that what is the importance of copyright and how, what is the level it can be taken to. So we must be like very, you should own what we do. Yeah. And we should be very clear of what is our inspiration, what has been our concept, so that we can, you know, be safe from such issues. Now, if someone copies your work of architecture, can he go to jail? This is a question that I'm going to ask. So the answer is that the Indian Copyright Act does not allow for a jail for a person who does copyright infringement for works of architecture. The court can also not fine the person. And once the building is constructed or in the process of construction, when it was constructed, it was an infringement, let's say, or when it will be constructed, it will be an infringement of copyright. Even then, there can be no injunction. The construction cannot be stopped. The building cannot be, demolished. The building cannot be made someone else's property. It cannot be given to the original author. But apart from works of architecture, if you copy a song, if you copy a painting, if you copy a movie in India, you'll be sent to jail for 6 months and you'll be fined 50,000 rupees. So what should you do in case your work of architecture is facing infringement by a third party? You have to approach the district civil court as per the Indian civil procedure and file a petition and file for damages in terms of monetary gain made by your work. So you can claim damages. And you know, because of the lack of these, because you cannot send people to jail, you cannot fine them. So there's a lack of these for architectural works in the Copyright Act. There can be no injunction, penalty, punishment, only commercial losses can be claimed. So now another question. So if an Indian architect is designing a building in Bangladesh, does it get protection under the Copyright Act, Indian Copyright Act 1957? Another question. If Le Corbusier, a French national, comes to India and makes buildings in India, does he get protection under the Copyright Act, Indian Copyright Act 1957? Answer is that the work should be located in India. Indian architect makes a building in Bangladesh, the other country's Copyright Act will be followed, not the Indian Copyright Act, because the building should be physically located in the Indian jurisdiction. Another thing is, architect, the author of the work, may be of Indian or foreigner. So Le Corbusier, any foreign architect comes to India and makes a building, he is the owner of the copyright of the building. Questions. So is it compulsory to register work for copyright protection in India? And another question is, do you have copyright over your work until you're dead, until you're alive only? What happens after you die? And what constitutes copyrightable work of architecture? So the first question is that there is a process, you know, the work, even though registration as a process exists, yet registration is not compulsory. The process of registration is you go to the copyright office, you file application, they issue your diary number, 30 days waiting for objections. If there are no objections, the examiner scrutinizes it, and you know, then the deputy registrar approves it and you get the copyright. But there is no registration required because there is a thing called deemed registration. That means if you have a work, if you have a model that you have an appointment letter for, you have made a submission to your teacher as an academic exercise, you've submitted your plans to the municipality for approvals, you have released a press release of your work, you have shared the work in a conference, in an institute, or in front of a learned society, you are immediately the owner of the copyright because you have in sense published your work. And this answer to the second question is that copyright is valid for 60 years after the death of the author. It is definitely valid after the author dies, but it is valid only till 60 years after that. What happens after 60 years, some people ask? So after 60 years of the death also, the authorship right remains. Your author throughout perpetuity of the universe. Only thing that has changed is that somebody after 60 years can use the work, sell it, and do whatever they want to do. You cannot claim copyright protection for it. What constitutes the copyrightable materials in India? The work of architecture, that's the building. Also the plan, the 3D and the 2D of the building. So now very important questions that, you know, we need to ask in India. Who owns the copyright? You know, so if you work as an architect with CPWD, that's the Central Public Works Department, and design a building, who's the owner of the copyright? So, and then second question, if you're a student of architecture and you design a building as part of an academic exercise, who owns the copyright? If you're an employee in an architectural office and design a building in your non-office hours and the building receives an award, who's the owner of the copyright? If you're an architectural intern doing 6 months training, you design a building on your own in the office, who owns the copyright over the building? So very important questions, let's answer them. If you're a CPWD employee, full-time employee, according to the tax laws of the country, then you are in an arrangement with the government that you are working for them. So it is a work for hire situation. The copyright owner is CPWD, but you will retain the author rights, which I'm going to talk about. Second is, if you're a student of architecture is making a submission, you are the copyright owner. Number three, if you are an employee in an architectural office and you do something in the non-work office hours, unless specified in the contract that you have signed. And if you are a full-time employee, according to the tax laws, in the if you're in the tax laws and you're working for the office, you're getting your PF cut, and you have all the employee benefits, then whatever you do becomes is an office copyright. The office has copyright over it, unless of course you have a written agreement contrary to it. You say when you're joining the office that copyright will be mine because I'm a professional. But if you do something in the non-office hours where you are not in an agreement, then the copyright is with you. Unless of course the office doesn't allow you to do non-office works, where there is a different problem. The problem is not of copyright, then the problem is of service issues, that you have not done your service properly, you have broken the contract of service. But as such, copyright, if you have not worked, if you're working on a building not issued to the office, if you're working on that building in non-office hours and you that building let's gets an award, then you are the owner of the copyright. Then you're an architectural intern. So interns are not employees. So whatever they do is their copyright. But when the intern is being hired, he needs to sign. And if he is signing a contract and that contract makes him an employee, then what happens is the office gets the copyright. Otherwise, if he's a short-term person doing work and the work has not being issued to him, for example, if I'm working in an office and the work is being issued to the office in the name of the office, even though I have worked. So this is a very dicey situation. Authorship claim on the drawing, you'll say drawn by, will be yours. But the work has been issued to the office and not to you as an intern. So then what happens is the work is a copyright of the office where you're working in a work for hire situation. But you always retain the authorship rights we are going to talk about. But what happens when you are doing a project while you were an intern and the off project was not of the office, then that is your copyright. You have gotten the work independently in your own free time, whatever your employment status then was, but the copyright and owner was you. So this takes to a very important matter that we are talking about this authorship and then we are talking about copyright. So what's this whole business? So it's not always about profit and loss. Copyright is also about honor and reputation of the artist slash creator. So moral rights after assignment, transfer of ownership and under employment, even after you have given assigned the moral the rights to somebody else of your copyright, even if you are under employment, you have moral rights to be identified as the author of the work. So what are the author's special rights independently of the author's copyright? And even after the assignment, either wholly or partly of the said copyright, the author of the work shall have the right to claim authorship of the work till the end of the universe. There is no time limit, no conditional requirement to this. Number two, he can restrain, he can stop somebody, or he can claim damages. He can, apply for damages and get compensated in respect of any distortion, mutilation, modification, or any act in relation to the work that is in question. If such distortion, mutilation, modification would be prejudicial, that means it is harming him. Is it harming his honor and his reputation? So he has the right to stop that work or claim damages over it. So what should architects in India do? This is my request to all the architects seeing this, all the architecture students, all the big people in the business of architecture in India, all the big people in architecture regulation, all the teachers of architecture, all the principals, all the people in COA, that we have to create a copyright society for the architectural work in India. Singers have it, composers have it, radio broadcasting it is there, TV rights it is there, but there should be one for architectural work so that we as architects can decide these things among ourselves and then go to the copyright office. We can create guideline. And the second important thing is we have to create guidelines for copyright infringement of works of architecture, because there are no case laws in India, no precedents in India, no guidelines as such. Only one thing inserted into the Copyright Act, work of architecture, and then it gives some basis. But how do you make rules? How do you do interpretation of that act is the question that I need to ask. and we need to resolve together as architectural fraternity. And you know what will be the function of this copyright society? It will be, you know, issuing license, collecting fees, you know. It will basically, the heart of this technical lingo is that this is going to create a space for architects to go to other architects who regulate this field and get copyright over their work. And you know, people can decide, architects can design among their own fraternity. So thank you, this was this architecture and copyright for you. I hope you learned something from it. And let's all hope that architecture in India reaches to the next level and we get better guidelines for architectural work, copyright, and we create an architectural society for copyright. Thank you.